Muchas gracias. Hola a todos y a todas. Les pido disculpa, hablo solo un poco español, pues voy a hacer dar la presentación en inglés. So, first of all, thank you for inviting me and giving me the opportunity to talk about inclusive entrepreneurship. My presentation will be centered on the innovative side of policies, but also programs in Europe aimed at fostering more inclusive entrepreneurship. I'll briefly touch upon entrepreneurship policy at the Commission, provide insights into programs focused on microfinance, a relevant instrument to making entrepreneurship accessible to all, and I will finish by sharing some thoughts on social policy innovation. Let me start by shedding some light on entrepreneurship policy at the Commission. Promoting a climate of entrepreneurship is essential in terms of job creation. It is a means to respond to the current employment crisis and to fight social exclusion. The Commission has a long history of supporting entrepreneurship, and it is a key element of the Europe 2020 strategy. As you may know, the Europe 2020 strategy of smart, inclusive, and sustainable growth sets the target of lifting at least 20 million people out of poverty and social exclusion by 2020. Since its adoption, and as a result of the economic and financial crisis, the EU is not making progress towards its target. The number of people at risk of poverty and social exclusion in the EU actually increased from 114 million people in 2009 to 124 million people in 2012. While the target set in 2010 remains valid, more efforts are needed to achieve it. The primary responsibility for delivering on the Europe 2020 targets is in the hands of the member states. In the field of social protection and social investment, i.e. the investment in people, the EU supports and complements the activities of the member states in the form of policy guidance, knowledge sharing, expertise, data and analysis, and financial support. More recently, the Entrepreneurship 2020 Action Plan, adopted in 2013, outlines a blueprint for decisive action to unleash Europe's entrepreneurial potential, to remove existing obstacles, and to revolutionize the culture of entrepreneurship in Europe. The main actions to be taken at both EU and member state levels to support entrepreneurship are summarized in this action plan. This plan has three pillars. One, on entrepreneurial education and training. A second, on tackling barriers. And a third, on reaching out to specific groups. An important element of this plan is indeed to support inclusive entrepreneurship and self-employment, as David mentioned, amongst those who are vulnerable to social exclusion. Today, EU support is currently provided directly or indirectly by six different DGs, or Directorate Generals, with a different focus ranging from innovation to education, competitiveness, regional development, and so on. The lead on entrepreneurship policy is taken by DG Grow, the Director General for Internal Market, Industry, Entrepreneurship, and SMEs. They typically look at this from the angle of competitiveness and growth. As for my Director General, so the Director General for Employment, Social Affairs, and Inclusion, we obviously look at the employment social angle. In other words, entrepreneurship care helps to create jobs and develop skills and to include the unemployed and the disadvantaged in society and the economy. Action by DG Employment focuses on the one hand on increasing knowledge of entrepreneurship and self-employment and facilitating access to mutual learning for member states and regions. On the other hand, actions have been taken by DG Employment to increase access to and availability of finance, which was the first main barrier, which David mentioned, to vulnerable groups, micro-enterprises and social enterprises. Perhaps just a few definitions, the terms I just mentioned. So a social enterprise combines running an enterprise with a social purpose. The main aim is to create a social impact rather than maximize profit for owners and shareholders. It's interesting to note that the social economy today employs over 11 million people in the EU, accounting for 6% of total employment. As for micro-enterprises, these are enterprises employing fewer than 10 people with a maximum annual turnover of 2 million euros. Today, they represent over 90% of European enterprises and are thus decisive for boosting jobs, growth, and investment in Europe. And in fact, 85% of new jobs in Europe are created by micro-enterprises. Newly established micro-enterprises generate on average, or create on average, 2 jobs. Now, what they both have in common, social enterprises and micro-enterprises, is one of the main obstacles that they face: the lack of access to finance. Microfinance, which includes guarantees, microcredit, i.e. loans up to 25,000 euros, equity and quasi-equity, which are extended to vulnerable persons that experience difficulties accessing credit, can help overcome this. Access to finance plays a significant role in Europe 2020 strategy, having a direct impact on 2 of its targets: employment and fighting poverty and social exclusion. Our support to microfinance for vulnerable groups and microenterprises was launched in 2010. The main reason was the mismatch between the demand on the one hand and the supply for finance. On the supply side, just to name a few examples, there was notably a lack of suitable financial instruments that were in place. Few investors were prepared to invest, and there was a lack of capacity and tools to assess the viability of business plans of microenterprises and also their social impact. On the demand side, also to name a few examples, often we see that microenterprises, social enterprises, are not necessarily investment ready or prepared to receive funding. And there's also a tendency to rely on grants. As David mentioned, here we're trying to push to move towards financial instruments that are payable, which provide an incentive for entrepreneurs to build their business. I will now mention 2 programs on which we work on the Commission that specifically addresses the challenges. The first, Progress Microfinance Facility, was therefore launched to help fill this gap, i.e. increase the availability of microcredit, these loans below 25,000 euros, for setting up or developing a small business. It's important to note that this facility does not directly finance entrepreneurs, but enables selected microcredit providers to increase lending by issuing guarantees and providing funding to increase the number of microloans. As you can see here, the EU contribution of 100 million euros was matched by the EIB, in other words, the European Investment Bank. And today we are well on track to reaching and even exceeding the target of 46,000 microloans worth half a billion euros by 2020. Today, under the Progress Microfinance Facility, 23 member states are currently covered through 83 operations with 63 different MFIs, including ones in Spain. And to date, this facility has helped to create or maintain over 60,000 jobs, which demonstrates the strong job creation effect. Now, the successor of this facility, the EU Programme for Employment and Social Innovation, i.e. EASY, was launched in 2014 and extends the EU support under its predecessor. This program, with a total EU budget of 193 million euros for a period 2014 through to 2020, is split into 2 strands. On the one hand, microfinance, and on the other hand, social entrepreneurship. In terms of microfinance, this is the top half of the slide that you see. This addresses the Europe 2020 objective of inclusive growth. Here, the Commission is intensifying its efforts to promote access to microfinance to microenterprises and vulnerable persons by supporting microcredit providers through guarantees, loans, capacity building, and technical assistance. On the other hand, easy social entrepreneurship strand, which is the bottom half of this slide, this addresses the objectives of smart and inclusive, and sustainable, growth. The aim here is to develop the social investment market and subsequently, in turn, help social enterprises to reach out to vulnerable groups. Now, so far, Easy has made a promising start. You might have heard that last week there was a journalist seminar, which our commissioner attended and a few other key persons, where we announced the signature of 6 guarantees under the Easy program, of which 1 Spanish financial intermediary was actually involved. I must emphasize that microfinance here is a key instrument for promoting inclusive entrepreneurship and fighting social and financial exclusion. This brings me to the final part of my presentation. Inclusive entrepreneurship policy is about looking into the reasons why specific groups are underrepresented among entrepreneurs and in looking into the member states' policies that can address this. These underrepresented groups, as David mentioned, includes women, immigrants, youth, seniors, the unemployed, and ethnic minorities. These groups face, as any entrepreneur, and some of you might be amongst us today, barriers in areas such as administration, regulation, access to finance, which I just touched upon, and so on. But such barriers are often more severe for these groups. Inclusive entrepreneurship can also be innovative. Now, according to the EU definition, innovation refers to the creation of new or significantly improved products, processes, marketing, organization that add value to markets, governments, and society. One form of innovation is social innovation. Social innovation means developing new ideas, services, and models to better address social issues. It invites input from public and private sector actors, including civil society, to improve social services. Social innovation is actually part of the Commission's social investment package, SIP. It must be embedded in policy making and connected to social priorities, such as implementing country-specific recommendations, including through the use of the European Social Fund. Perhaps a word on social policy experimentation. Now, this concept tests the validity of innovative policies by collecting evidence about the real impact of measures on people. Here, the principle is to test a policy intervention on a small scale so as to evaluate its efficacy before deciding to scale it up. These experiments, 1, bring innovative answers to social needs, 2, are small-scale probing interventions to test impact, 3, are made in conditions where their impact can actually be measured, and finally, 4, can be scaled up if the results are conclusive and convincing. EU governments need to develop regulatory environments that enable and encourage social innovation and the social economy, in addition to providing sufficient financial support. Here, the Commission's role is to provide guidance on 2 things. On the one hand, how to use social policy innovation when implementing country-specific recommendations, and on the other, how to use European structural and investment funds for this purpose. Finally, not everyone has the right mindset and skills or even chooses to be entrepreneur. Therefore, policy measures should be selective in terms of targeted population and comprehensive in terms of integrated support. In our work with the OECD, we find that what works best is when entrepreneurs or potential ones get integrated packages of support. Such packages combine tools for facilitating access to finance, such as microfinance, with targeted business development services to address possible shortcomings in skills, such as coaching and mentoring. Support, of course, should not be limited to startups. What is much more important than startup rates are actually the survival rates of young firms. A high startup rate can go hand in hand with a high mortality rate of these young firms. What therefore really matters is that young firms can grow to become sustainable. And the support should indeed start with creating a conducive environment which aims at reducing barriers of both administrative and of financial nature. I would like to conclude by quoting a recent column of the Bruegel think tank. Karen Wilson, a senior fellow at Bruegel and an author of a number of publications on entrepreneurship and finance, posted end of May a blog entitled, How to Unleash the Financing of High Growth Firms in Europe, 10 Recommendations for Catalyzing Growth. She wrote that entrepreneurship should be celebrated in Europe to help create a more entrepreneurial culture. So, let us today celebrate inclusive entrepreneurship and work together to create an entrepreneurial culture in Europe that promotes social inclusion. With this final thought, I would like to conclude my presentation, and I thank you for your attention. I will now take on any questions, if there are any.
Muchísimas gracias. Es su turno. Él ofrece un turno de palabra. ¿Alguien tiene alguna pregunta que hacer? ¿Alguien desea hacer alguna pregunta? ¿Es su turno de palabra? ¿Quiere? Seguimos tímidos. Aquí sí que hay una palabra, por favor. Muchas gracias.
Hola, buenos días. Creo que sería interesante que comentaras qué órgano. ¿En inglés? ¿En español?
Yeah, es español solo.
Efectivamente, has comentado que hay una entidad española que está gestionando, que ha sido aprobada para la gestión de fondos sí, etcétera. Creo que estaría bien comentar qué organización es, porque bueno, pues es una información interesante para organizaciones que están trabajando con personas que probablemente puedan acceder a lo mejor a este tipo de financiación.
Absolutely, I'd be more than happy to comment here. So, as I mentioned, there were actually six financial intermediaries that benefited under the EASY program in terms of guarantees. So, ones from Spain, Italy, UK, Romania, the Netherlands, and another country which I can't recall, but I can tell you afterwards. Actually, the institution from Spain is Laboral Kutxa. To give you the details on the transaction, I don't know the numbers by heart, but what I know is that in terms of the guarantees that we have signed, there are actually the volumes that we expect to reach, thanks to these six guarantees with these financial intermediaries, would potentially reach 237 million euros but in terms of microloans. So it's indeed a very interesting point to mention, and so thank you for your question.
Más turnos de palabra. Por aquí tenemos otra petición.
Buenos días y gracias por su intervención. Nosotros estamos trabajando en un ámbito muy concreto, que es el emprendimiento de mujeres con riesgo de exclusión social, pero en el medio rural. Con lo cual, mi pregunta sería, para este nicho concreto de público objetivo, de futuras emprendedoras, ¿existe por parte del Fondo Social Europeo algún programa que fuera más concreto? Es decir, que trabajara el ámbito del medio rural y centrado en mujeres con problemas con riesgo de exclusión social. Gracias.
Thank you for your question. With regards to the European Social Fund specifically, if I may just, before answering your question, give perhaps to the wider audience who might not necessarily know this fund. So basically this fund, European Social Fund, ESF, is about making sure that EU citizens have the right skills for the right jobs. This challenge is tackled together by the EU and its member states through the ESF. And every year the EU actually dedicates more than 10 billion euros to the ESF, to which member states add their share. In other words, every year, the ESF actually helps to support and train over 10 million people in the European Union. Now, With regards to your specific question about women entrepreneurs, if I understood correctly, in rural areas, there I must say I do not have a specific knowledge of myself, of the programs that have been launched. But what I can definitely do is look into that and get back to you with a correct response. So rather than saying something that might lead you to mislead you, I would prefer to give you a better answer. But maybe just to complement on that, so what this European Social Fund does is, one, help and to improve education, two, to create new job opportunities in supporting businesses, three, to support people to start their own business, so including women entrepreneurs in rural areas, as you mentioned, four, to investing in better public services, five, helping people to learn new skills, six, offering career counseling and mentoring, and finally, helping disadvantaged people into work. I believe there was another question.
La mañana se anima, sí, sí que tenemos más turnos de palabra.
Thank you. I'm going to try to speak in English, my opportunity. So many public funds are not available for entrepreneurship when they have a start because they are not already unemployment. Do you understand what I want to say? So what do you think about this? Because it's very important destinate funds for this phase of the entrepreneurship.
Sorry, would you mind just repeating the first part of your question? So I didn't catch the first part.
Yes, I would try to say that there are many public funds that are not available for entrepreneurship when they have a start because they are not already unemployment people. You know, because they start an economic activity.
Right. So you mean people who are not unemployed,
yeah,
and who are starting their own business? How can they benefit from funds?
Yeah.
So indeed, I mean, when we looked at disadvantaged groups, we mainly focus on unemployed persons, youth, seniors. But I must say there are also overlaps in the sense that, so although we do specifically target through our programs, as the ones that I mentioned here, unemployed persons, of course, I mean, when people who are in a position where they are at risk of being socially excluded, or at risk of poverty, if they fall in that category, of course, in one way or another, they do fall within the realm and the scope of our programs. So maybe just a thought on, for example, youth in this case. So in many countries in the EU, such as young graduates who graduate from university and are unable to find a job, of course, I mean, these persons, for example, would fall into the categories of the programs that we specifically launch. Yes. Does that answer your question?
No.
Voy a hablar en español porque no me he hecho entender. Mi pregunta era si hay fondos públicos que se destinan a emprendedores cuando ya se han puesto en marcha las empresas porque ya no son desempleados. Y es una fase en la que estamos de acuerdo en la que hay que apoyar a los emprendedores, pero no se destinan fondos para esta fase.
So yes, now I better understand your question. So actually these funds are not only for the startup phase. We actually have funds, and I can give you the names later on, but where we actually not only look at the startup phase, but throughout the whole life cycle of enterprises, where companies who have already maybe started a few years ago and are still having difficulties to really try and launch, they can potentially benefit from these funds. So yes, so we have different programs, such as, for example, the SME initiative that's been launched, where parts of the life cycles of certain enterprises are actually covered by these funds. Yes.
Buenos días. Trabajo en la unidad administrada del Fondo Social Europeo y respecto a la petición que ha hecho esta persona anterior respecto al tema de ayudas a mujeres en zonas rurales, yo le quería decir que para el nuevo periodo de programación, como ha comentado Carmen Casero, ya está aprobado el programa operativo de inclusión social y economía social, Uno de los organismos intermedios va a ser el Instituto de la Mujer, como ya lo fue en el programa de lucha contra la discriminación, y ahora mismo se está desarrollando, resolviendo una convocatoria para los futuros beneficiarios de parte de este programa, con lo cual a partir de estos beneficiarios tendrán también apoyo a las mujeres en zona rural. Y luego hay otro programa operativo que está pendiente de aprobar y que probablemente tenga un organismo intermedio que es dependiente del Ministerio de Agricultura, que es la Dirección General de Desarrollo Rural. A partir de ahí, todas las convocatorias que salgan pues irán dirigidas fundamentalmente a mujeres en tema rural.
Muchísimas gracias. Agradecemos muchísimo esta dinámica en la que cada uno aporta, porque precisamente ese es el espíritu real de este tercer foro de emprendimiento inclusivo. Damos las gracias y vamos a pasar la palabra a otra persona que la ha pedido, por favor. Muchas gracias por su colaboración.
Muy buenos días a todos y a todas. Le agradezco la invitación. Yo quería preguntarle a usted sobre fondos europeos que vayan destinados específicamente a mujeres supervivientes de violencia de género, inmigrantes y con edades de 54 años a 19 años. Si bien es cierto, la crisis en España tiene rostro de mujer, a las que más ha golpeado, las que más estamos en situación de exclusión, de discriminación sobre las mujeres. Muchas mujeres jóvenes que estaban en nuestra entidad han tenido que salir fuera de España en búsqueda de empleo. Nosotros nos dedicamos a atender a mujeres víctimas de violencia de género. Tenemos un emprendimiento muy potente, pero necesitamos hacerlo sostenible, tanto para las profesionales que somos supervivientes de violencia de género, como para poder hacer sostenible los programas de intervención con las mujeres, es decir, el apoyo legal, psicológico. Tenemos un comedor social donde hemos recibido una pequeña subvención, pero como estábamos en una situación de crisis, fue que nos animamos a este emprendimiento. Gracias a que nuestro proyecto fue seleccionado por Acción contra el Hambre, hemos tenido una excelente formación durante un año, que es lo que nos ha permitido posicionarnos como emprendedoras, pero no queremos morir en el intento. Queremos sobrevivir ahora al hambre, a la precariedad, a la discriminación, como ya una vez salvamos nuestras vidas. Muchas gracias.
So thank you for your comment. Maybe just to understand what was the question exactly? My question was just to clarify, what was your question exactly?
Nosotras con este emprendimiento social, que aparte de ser la esperanza para la sostenibilidad económica de las profesionales como de las mujeres víctimas de violencia de género, también tenemos una filosofía y una ética y una estética de incidir y de tener un impacto social con nuestro emprendimiento y un cambio de mirada, pero esto necesitamos dinero para hacer sostenible este sueño, este emprendimiento. O sea, tenemos todo el proyecto, es posible por el resultado de cuentas, por todo este planteamiento que tenemos ya técnico, pero por supuesto que necesitamos liquidez económica, porque lo que hacemos es muy importante, que tiene que ver con una vida libre de violencia, con que más mujeres no mueran asesinadas, con que tengamos empleo y con incidir en una sociedad en relaciones igualitarias, con que las mujeres seamos escuchadas y tengamos un protagonismo como lo que necesita una sociedad democrática, que haya mujeres.
So thank you for that. So indeed, I mean, as a program that I mentioned, EASY, one of the two strands was actually the social entrepreneurship strand. And there, from what I understand, I mean, from your case, which seems, of course, to be a very important case, can potentially benefit from this program in terms of financing. So, of course, I mean, I'd be happy to discuss more in bilaterally, depending on the situation of your organization, to see how we can potentially find a way how you can benefit from this program. So, of course, I mean, social entrepreneurship, as I said, the idea is to help develop these social enterprises, such as yourselves, to really grow and to continue helping persons in need, such as the persons that you mentioned. And maybe one point that I did not mention in my presentation about social entrepreneurship. So on the one hand, microfinance, here we're talking about credits, loans that are limited to 25,000 euros. But in the case of social entrepreneurship, these investments can go up to 500,000 euros. So I just wanted to make the clear distinction between the two.
Más turnos de palabra, quizá. Sí, el caballero.
Thank you very much for information. And bueno, hablo en castellano, sí. La pregunta va dirigida no tanto al modelo que se tiene con jóvenes, sino un poquito antes, en el tema de adolescentes. Es decir, gran parte de en nuestro país, y sobre todo hay una tasa de abandono y de fracaso de más de un 30% de adolescentes que fracasan en secundaria. Y se intenta ampliar, se está discutiendo ahora mismo la ampliación de la escolarización hasta los 18 años. ¿De algún modo qué vías de financiación hay para trabajar esa edad muy concreta? Estamos hablando de 16, 18 años, porque gran parte de esos chavales y chavalas jóvenes que fracasan, la accesibilidad o los puestos de trabajo que van a tener son puestos de trabajo muy poco cualificados, se les paga muy poco, están precarios. Y evidentemente podemos hacer mentorías, podemos hacer microcréditos, etcétera. Pero tenemos una dificultad a veces de cómo estos chavales, cuando hacen su empresa, acceden también a un tipo de certificado de formación que les permita también lanzarse en ese modelo. Y es triste, pero demográficamente vamos a tener un número muy grande de adolescentes en países como España, venido de nuestro situación económica hace 8 o 10 años, en la cual había una situación económica buena. Si fracasan en torno al 36% de los adolescentes, ¿qué hacemos? Y también si hay ayudas de cara a un modelo diferente de emprendimiento, no aquel que supone que voy a hacer mi empresa, sino cómo yo también mejoro mi comunidad, ¿no? Porque todos sabemos que de 100 empresas fracasan bastante y el acceso al crédito no es fácil. Con 1.000 euros es difícil hacer una empresa y mucho más difícil es, por ejemplo, encontrar un lugar donde acogerse, donde meterse. Entonces, un poquito de decir, esas ideas innovadoras se pueden trabajar en edades más tempranas, qué tipo de ayudas hay y qué tipo de ayudas, por ejemplo, en la inclusión en el ámbito educativo de estos adolescentes que no jóvenes, se promueven por parte de la Unión Europea.
So thank you for your questions. So perhaps to answer the first, which funds would be available, especially for these teens, so from what I understood, from 16 to 18 years, and given the high dropout rates, I think you mentioned the 36% from school. So from my understanding, and of course, I mean, do not quote me on this, is I would believe that the European social funds could definitely be a potential possibility to worth that could address this issue here, but regarding the specifics, what I would suggest is, because unfortunately my colleague who is an expert on this this field is not here with me, but I can definitely take this up with him, and then what I suggest is getting back to you with a specific answer. But from my understanding, I believe this European social funds can provide a formal answer one way or another. Now, in regards to your second question, so which funds would be available for, I believe, is it in terms of entrepreneurship, so not only startup companies, but helping improving the community and also access to credit? Well, similarly, as I replied to one of your colleagues here who asked the question, I mean, in a certain sense, this is also linked to social entrepreneurship in the wider sense. So this could also potentially benefit from the program that I mentioned earlier. Regarding the specifics of the parameters that you mentioned, I would need to go into more details to really understand clearly what is the what are we actually talking about, and based on that, I could give you a well-formulated answer.
Muchísimas gracias, Shadin. muchísimas gracias a este ponente que con la que verdad hemos empezado a hacer más preguntas. Recuerdo que este es el espíritu de la mañana de hoy, llevarnos herramientas que luego nos sirvan para poder hacer un trabajo más eficiente y mucho mejor en este terreno del emprendimiento inclusivo.